Hello and welcome. I'm very pleased to participate in this second WHO Global School on Refugee and Migrant Health and to kick off this very special session on financing healthcare for refugees and migrants. Our world today is defined by tremendously vibrant human mobility within and across borders, with an estimated 1 billion people today on the move. Many move by choice, others because they are out of choices. But what is clear, and has been widely covered in the first 4 days of this global school, is that the migration process too often comes with hardship, heightened vulnerability, and limited access, if any, to health services and social protection. And this, despite the existence of a large body of international conventions and commitments protecting migrants' rights to access basic services, including health. This includes the Covenant on Social, Economic, and Cultural Rights, universal health coverage in the 2030 Agenda, the Global Compact for Safe, Orderly, and Regular Migration, and of course, the WHO Global Action Plan to promote the health of refugees and migrants. Before COVID-19, some might have been tempted to think that this is a problem of a few and a human rights issue only. But the pandemic has shed light on the fact that investing in migrant health is both the right thing and the smart thing to do. For a safer tomorrow, access to health services and social protection must become much more inclusive, regardless of immigration status and legal documentation, nationality, culture, language, and individual financial means. The question for policymakers now is, how can we afford to do it? The truth is, we cannot afford not to. First and foremost, studies have shown that it is much more costly for societies to leave any category of migrant without adequate health coverage. There are two reasons for this. One, migrants who cannot afford professional health services or choose to self-diagnose or self-medicate have a negative ripple effect that endangers individual and public health. One salient example is the multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis, which happens when people don't have adequate access to treatment and support, with devastating snowball consequences for individuals, their families, and communities. And two, migrants and their dependents who have access to low-cost primary health care for conditions that could have been prevented or effectively managed at an early stage are not cornered into using very costly emergency care services. Another point I want to make is that migrants are critical socioeconomic contributors to all aspects of our societies, both where they live and also back home. Compromising their health will also have repercussions on productivity for societies. Health, agriculture, transport, research, industrial production, construction, you name it. Their work and the value they create are key in achieving all 17 goals of the 2030 Agenda. According to the World Bank, more than $500 billion are sent in remittances to low and middle-income countries every year, a major factor in poverty reduction worldwide and in improving welfare, health, and living conditions in these countries. The widespread economic impacts of the pandemic, which disproportionately affect migrants, failed to put a significant dent in remittances in 2020. They only dropped by 2.4% rather than the 20% originally predicted by the World Bank. In addition, the excessive out-of-pocket health costs that migrants who are overly represented in the informal sector are currently paying all over the world exacerbates their socioeconomic vulnerability. The final point I want to make is, solutions exist to make healthcare truly inclusive. To succeed, we must engage all sectors of government, local authorities, communities themselves, and the private sector. While research in this area remains limited, some countries show the way with innovative approaches for migrant inclusion, such as contributory social security and health insurance schemes, employer-based health insurance, tax-based schemes, and social protection agreements between source and destination countries that include portable healthcare benefits. For instance, over a decade ago, countries that heavily rely on remittances, such as Sri Lanka and the Philippines, put in place health insurance schemes for their departing migrant workers. Germany and Turkey have an agreement allowing Turkish labor migrants to keep their health benefits after they return to Turkey. And during the COVID-19 pandemic, many countries such as Portugal, the UK, Ireland, the US, and others took concrete measures to ensure diagnostic, therapeutic, and immunization solutions were accessible to migrants irrespective of their legal status. We must remember that health is an investment in human capital, and there is no time to waste. Addressing migrant health not only protects public health, it also contributes to social and economic development. Given this win-win equation, and in our increasingly mobile and diverse world, IOM calls on countries to take concrete steps for affordable and accessible health services for all, in line with universal health coverage principles. Thank you for your attention and for joining us today. I look forward to a very fruitful discussion.